pays their taxes? I didn't see you, Jonah, lifting your hand. You said you liked it. Well, you probably want to answer yes in case there's an IRS representative in the congregation, but generally I think, no, we don't. But generally I think we do pay our taxes. We don't like paying taxes, but we do. I mean, times have really not changed that much. 2,000 years ago, they didn't like to pay taxes. Now, at the same time, 2,000 years later, we don't like to pay taxes either. But we do. We pay our taxes, and I think we generally recognize, although some can disagree with me, we generally recognize that it's a necessary part of our civil life together. Some, of course, say we should pay less taxes. Some say we should pay more taxes. Some say no taxes at all. But generally, we agree we should pay taxes. And we agreed at some point this is a good idea to provide services for our country, for everybody, to have law enforcement, to have a fire department, to have education that's basic, just to have roads to drive on, to get down the street. We thought we should provide this for everybody in our country. This is some common ground that we've come together around, something that we can agree upon. People came together, they shared their opinions, they shared their voices, and a decision was made. This is a part of the civil fabric of our nation together, finding that common ground in a variety of perspectives. So it seems that at this point in our country and our history, common ground is few and far between. Common ground is hard to find. If we look at our reading from the gospel, the Pharisees and the Herodians, they found common ground. Now, the Pharisees are like the religious group, and then the Herodians are the ones who support King Herod, who is part of the Empire of Rome. So they really didn't get along that much about a lot of things. It was the religious side and the political side coming together. And they came together against Jesus because they didn't like what he was doing. They were enemies that became collaborators against Jesus. And I guess their collaboration probably didn't last that long because they really didn't like each other very much. They didn't like each other. But they united to put Jesus to this test. Basically, you got to choose between us, Jesus. Choose religion. Choose the Pharisees. Choose God. Or choose politics. Choose the Herodians. Choose Caesar, the emperor. They put Jesus to that test. But Jesus is like, hey, I'm not hating. You guys, I tried that on the first service. I was like, Jesus was like, I'm not hating, and everybody looked at me with blank stares. I thought I would get a better reaction here in this service, but it was not wrong. Man, it's too old for the young people among us and too new for the older generation. I don't know. I'm in between. But he was like, don't hate. I'm not hating. Don't worry. Stop the hating, people. Stop the hating. You can pay your taxes. Sure, go ahead. Pay your taxes. But then the question that each one of them and each one of us has to answer is, what is really God's and what is really the emperor's? Does anybody want to answer that question?
Everything is God's.
I think I heard something.
Everything is God's.
Angela, were you here at the first service?
I was not.
You are right. Angela, you get something, woo-hoo! A high five later. You get a high five for that. Yes, it's really a trick question. It's a trick question because everything is God's, all of creation. It says in the book of Isaiah that God created everything, even good and evil. Because back in those times, in that place of the world, there was a God for evil and there was a God for good. No, God created both God, good and evil. God created everything in all of creation. So all we have is, of course, God's. And it's not what I want to have happen with creation. It's what God wants to have happen. It's not what I want to have happen politically. It's what God wants to have happen politically. And this system that we have where we can come together in a democratic society, express our opinions, share them with one another, and listen to one another, that's the system that God has given to us in this place and in this time for us to use. So we need to be a part of things in our society as individuals and as a church together, because we are in some desperate need of some common ground in our country. The Bible says that God's righteousness is coming upon us. There's no doubt about it. There's nothing we can do to get away from God's righteousness. Even leaders that we don't like in our country and in our world can still be used for God's purposes. There was this leader in ancient times. His name was Cyrus. He was the king of Persia. And in Isaiah, it says that God has made Cyrus his anointed one, his shepherd. This was some tough news for the people of Israel, because what did Persia do to Israel? Anybody? All you history buffs out there? It's before, no? Okay. Going back 2,500 years ago or so, he conquered Israel. I mean, Persia was an empire that expanded, conquered all the territories around them. And yet here you have the prophet Isaiah saying that even Cyrus is just a tool of God's purpose. Anybody can be used for God's purpose in our world. Maybe in unexpected ways as well. They can be used to serve God. Service is a big part of our identity as this church, Claremont Lutheran Church, Iglesia Luterana. We find our identity in service to others in so many different ways. Just a couple weeks ago, we had the quilts here. 229 quilts that were sent out. Facebook was going off the chain when they saw all those quilts. We had more likes than we've had because of those quilts that were made day in and day out here. And every week, people are taking sandwiches to be served to the homeless in need. And Friday mornings, people can come here and get food for the week, fresh vegetables and fruit. And Thursday evenings, coming together and sharing a meal in our community. We find our identity as Christians, as people of God, in that service. And we also find our identity, I believe, in this particular place, in this community, because we are a bilingual church. It's different. It's unique. Something that not all churches experience. So it gives us an opportunity to have this possibility to share in our world a countercultural identity that most really don't get to participate in our society. I think we need to take more time to share in our relationships with one another. I mean, if you get a chance to, if you have the time, it would be great. You can talk to somebody at the Spanish worship, have coffee with them, invite them, get to know them, learn a little bit of Spanish maybe, practice your Spanish from grade school and elementary. Maybe even the 8:30 worship. I mean, sometimes we don't even get to talk to each other across the English worship services. And it will be important to build that identity together, to find common ground. It's been difficult in this church. I know it has been difficult to have two languages in one congregation. But we've been able to find common ground together. We've been able to be transformed as God's people. And that reputation has reached outside of these walls. And I feel that God is calling this church to an even greater reputation of faith than it has ever known in this unique identity that we have. To be drawn together and united in a world that constantly wants to divide us from one another. United because of our calling to justice in the world, because of our relationships with those who suffer, and our relationships in general across cultures, across languages, across ages, and all kinds of different boundaries that support us. And while all that is so, so important, those relationships, our identity, our deepest identity is found in Christ. That truly brings us together, our common ground here in this church. So that even when things look desperate in the world around us, we know that God is working actively to restore our world. We can hope in God's righteousness. We can hope that out of chaos and division that we see, something new will emerge. So we must be involved politically as well as spiritually in our world. We must work together so that God's values will flourish all around us in society. Each one of us must come together, share our opinions, and really, really take the time to listen to the other person. I recently heard about this show that's coming out. There's a comedian named Sarah Silverman. You guys heard of Sarah Silverman?
Yeah.
She has this new show coming out. It's called I Love America. I Love America. The basic premise of this show is that she's going to go around to different families all throughout the United States and just sit down, have dinner with them, and have a conversation together. So she gives a sneak preview, the first show that's going to come out, and I got to watch that show. And it was really a fascinating and interesting show. I highly recommend it. She goes and visits with this family from Louisiana. And they had been like shrimp fishers or something, and they had got pushed off their land from Hurricane Katrina. So she goes and visits with them, and they're kind of getting to know. These are avid Trump supporters, gun rights, the whole deal. Exactly the opposite of Sarah Silverman, if you know anything about her. She's the total opposite of this family, politically speaking. But they take the time to sit down with one another, and they are talking about different issues, and she's just getting to know them, and they're getting to know her, and they start talking about things, and yeah, there was some tension, there was some difference between them, but they didn't let it boil over to ruin the relationship that they began. They got to grow together, understand one another a little bit more, and see how they could kind of proceed together in a new relationship that they had formed. That's what we get the opportunity to do in this country. We get the opportunity to get to know somebody who disagrees with us. And in this church, we get the opportunity to proceed forward in a loving relationship with that person, no matter what. That's the system that we have to work with, my friends. That's what God has given us to work with. And we need to take the opportunity to really imagine how we can use it to our advantage. To learn from other people. To grow in our understanding of the world. And really learn how we can love somebody across great differences in our perspectives. We can do it. We can come together and find common ground. No matter what we decide upon. Maybe you guys are much smarter, not maybe, I know you are much smarter than I am. Maybe you have some ideas for what we can do as a church or we can do individually. I asked this of the first service as well, so I have their ideas in case you don't want to come up with anything. Pastor John? No, this is you. This is you right now. What's something we can do? As a community. Maybe you need more time to think about it. I get that too. I'm generally introverted. I like to think things through on my own. How can we come together across issues that divide us as a nation? I see Greg smiling over there. I want to know what Greg is thinking. I heard something over here. Sharing a meal together, just like Sarah Silverman did in her show. It's a great way around food, around company, to get to know one another a little bit better. So maybe God is calling you, God is touching your heart, to invite somebody over to your house. Somebody that you normally don't talk to get to know them, their history, and so that they can learn about you. And really take the time to listen what it is somebody else is saying. Anybody else? One thing that Katie Neal mentioned, she was in the 8:30 service, and it goes along with what Michael said, is she said, come to our Thursday night dinners. If you haven't been to the Thursday night dinners, I highly recommend it. You get so many people from different backgrounds and parts of our community that come together to share a meal. You can really find somebody and get to know new people there that you would never meet out walking on the street. It's a wonderful opportunity. Well, I don't know. There's so many ways. I want you to really, when you go home, think about that. Think about that and come talk to me about it. I'd love to be a part of it too. As we find new ways as a community, as a congregation, that we can grow in relationship with one another and with others. And no matter what we decide to do, we find our calling in one thing. That is God's will in our lives. That is Jesus Christ. It's so central. We have to keep coming back to that reality. When our relationship, the culture, the love that we share are all wonderful things, but we need a living God who can bring clarity and vision to our lives, who is a secure foundation for us no matter what we come against in this life. From that foundation, nothing can or will stop us from uniting together as God's people. That foundation means that justice will rule on this earth. The poor and the oppressed, the homeless will be honored and blessed in our community. And all people will find grace and salvation so that we can all rejoice together. With all of creation, we can rejoice and sing praises to our God. In the psalm that's a part of our lectionary readings for this week, it talks about all of creation praising God. So we can imagine the fields rejoicing, the trees clapping their hands, the roaring ocean waves resounding, the stars twinkling in the sky, all in praise of God. With our proclamation here together on this day, with how we live our lives as we go forth from here, we can share in that praising of God. We can. But we have to feel it in our hearts, in our bones, in order to receive it into our minds. We have to experience God in order to believe it's real. I'm talking about God's love, God's power, God's mercy right now, active in your life, working to make justice a reality, working to grow in relationship. That's why we say, I'm feeling the Spirit right now.
Are
you feeling the Spirit right now? Say it with me. Say, I'm feeling the Spirit right now.
I'm feeling the Spirit right now.
That's why we shout out, glory.
Glory.
Oh, you got to do better than that. Say, glory.
Every breath, all that I am. Shout to the Lord.